Mr. Connors.
Hey, Fred, how was the wedding?
Well, I just wanted to thank you for making Debbie go through with it and everything.
All I did was fan the flame of her passion for you, Fred.
You are the best.
No, you are the best. Rita, this is Debbie and Fred Kleiser.
Hi.
Here you go, kids. Congratulations.
What is this? No way.
No way. WrestleMania! No way!
Thank you, Mr. Connors. You're a real pal.
Oh, this is the best.
Baby, if you ever wonder whatever became of Baby Oil and Blow. That's all I really had. I just like the WKRP theme song.
Baby Oil and Blow, WKRP.
Yeah. WKRP and Baby Oil and Blow. It's kind of my happy place, you know? Somebody's like, go to your happy place or whatever. Like, ooh, shit's getting rough.
My happy place is just workshopping parody song bits.
So I go,
that's what I do.
I got two things that always make me feel better, comfort me.
Mm-hmm.
Theme song from WKRP in Cincinnati.
Right.
And when things are really tough.
Oh, no.
Theme song from Taxi.
Oh, okay, yeah. That's a little curveball because generally that song makes people feel so awful. But not you, huh?
No, I just think about driving a taxi across the Brooklyn Bridge and just listening to that song, which is titled Angela, by the way.
Sure.
And just being like, maybe it gets better.
I'd rather listen to the song from MASH and hit my dick with a hammer, I think.
Well, that's a good song, too. I do like that song. You knew that,
really
though.
Is good.
You knew that. We're back. Funeral season is over.
Back in black.
Yeah. Back in black.
Black because you're going to so many funerals.
Yeah, too many. Too many. Lost two people in my family, but I won $200 this weekend, so...
Would you... Somebody selling scratch-offs at the funeral?
Well, we did do scratch-offs, yeah. We won a 20 on that, but Memphis Tina and I hit big on the slots last night.
Wow.
Because that shit's legal in Illinois.
Okay.
You go to a bar, throw a 20 in.
Why not?
Just throw a 20 in the machine. Max bet.
Bilk some money out of drunk
Let
people.
It ride.
Keep that economy going.
Yeah. Oh, you don't even know who we are anymore. It's me, big time Matt O. With me, as always, you get to be Brian Costello to my Gino Carabello. I'm talking Nate Adams.
Oh, hoy hoy, everybody. Those are a couple of ethnic-ass names.
Yeah,
but... just threw at me.
Your guy's from Indiana, just like you are.
Really?
Yeah.
I didn't catch that. Nor did I catch... Very much
doesn't
this
matter.
Latest episode of Primetime Wrestling
doesn't matter
that we've been watching specifically from January 18th, 1988. Because you know, we were going to talk about this a week ago until all those people died.
Yeah,
and then I don't know how I'm expected to, you know, through my grief, remember something that I watched 2 weeks ago and remember where each of these jobbers are from. I personally don't know how you're holding up so well. Like
I told you, WKRP in Cincinnati and the
sociopath
theme from
Taxi.
You ask
me, there's deep, disturbing sociopathic tendencies that you're exhibiting right now.
Yeah, it's all just going to just come to a grinding halt and, well, more so like an explosion at some point.
Fully detached from...
Until then.
You should be processing your emotions here.
But
clearly, how many beers did you bring to drink while we're recording this?
How many did I have in the car on the way over? That's the question.
I don't know. Is it legal to drink beers in cars in Illinois, too? Living in the Wild West over there.
Yeah.
Right across that state line.
It's like Deadwood over there.
Oh, that sounds cool.
That would be
Everybody's
cool, huh?
Calling each other cocksuckers.
Or cunt.
I don't like to use the C word.
Hell, swearing
I'm just kidding.
Does.
I say
yeah.
it all the time.
Hell yeah.
That'd be cool to live back there in Deadwood.
Yeah.
I'd be calling everybody cunts.
Yeah, and people would be all right with it.
In general. Somebody might take a shot at you every once in a while, but
that's
to be expected. I'm used to that. Over here on this side of the state line, you know, this is where you can just buy all the guns you want and then shoot people.
Yeah. Did you go to the big gun show that was in town over the weekend?
No, but I stopped by and shook hands with all of the people who buy armfuls of guns and then, you know, sell them to teenagers in Chicago so that they can murder each other by the hundreds.
I had a chance to work.
Good men. Good, you know, upstanding men down there.
Got a chance to work security for the gun show.
Oh, yeah? Yeah, you heard those protesters were showing up, and you were like, busy. Fuck this.
I was busy with funeral things.
I don't like to work for my money.
Yeah, well, there's that, too.
Some shit might pop off. Too. I like jobs where I can put my feet up on a desk.
Hell yeah. Like Barney Miller.
Barney Miller and...
That's a good theme song, too.
Every podcaster out there. That's what... Yeah. Put your feet up on a desk and talk into a microphone.
Yeah, buddy.
Talking about pro wrestling from the 1980s. Let's do the rundown.
Ooh, yeah.
Let's get this rundown out of the way.
Ooh, yeah.
We got a lot of matches on this primetime wrestling. We got to work through them. First match, Sika. That big old nasty brown dude.
Mm-hmm.
He's in there against SD Jones. Just like shucking and jiving. Happy man. Wins with a sunset flip.
Mm-hmm.
Shockingly enough, they can't say enough negative things about this guy in commentary, but they keep putting him over.
Yep.
Sherry, sensational Sherry. Sherry Martel. She's the women's champion, and she's in there against Rockin' Robin, 80s sensation. Sherry wins this. I think
roll up with a handful of
tights. Yeah, she got her knees up on a splash, and then and the match is over, and both the girls had their high beams on. So I was overall pretty pleased with how this thing shook out. That 80s spandex, it's nothing compared to those outfits the girls wear these days. Not standing up to any nipple action. British Bulldogs, they're in there with the aforementioned Brian Costello and Gino Caravallo, Indiana zone.
Yep, South Bend.
Really just sounds like he's from some shithole fucking Italian neighborhood. And
Costello's from South Bend. I don't know Caravallo. I think he was from like Long Island or some shit.
Definitely from one of those New England shitholes. He's got to be.
Mm-hmm.
Dynamite wins this one with a big backdrop off the second rope.
Yup.
Ooh, then we go into 8-man tag action. Big ol' 8-man tag. We got the Bolsheviks, the Russians, and they're teamed up with the Conquistadors from south of the border.
Somewhere
how
in South America.
Yeah, it's very vague. They're versus the Killer Bees, B. Brian Blair and Jumping Jim Brunzel.
Mm-hmm.
But they're in masks at this point, which is strange.
Yeah.
Like, are we supposed to know their names?
Even though they wrestled for like 2 years not in masks?
Anyway, they're teamed up with the JYD Bee and Animal Bee. That's a great big team with a lot of star power there.
JYDB.
JYDB gets the pin after a power slam. So
yep.
Good for him. That wasn't enough excitement for one episode. We've got another match coming up. Canadian strongman Dino Bravo.
Oh, God.
Take off, eh?
Man involved in that big bench press competition is coming up, in case you didn't hear.
No, that's in NWA WCW.
There might be another one up here in this company, too. So there's a lot of people getting over bench press competitions here in 1988. A little bit of a trend. Dino wins with a side slam.
Side suplex.
Isn't there against Jerry Allen?
Side suplex.
Side slam, I'd say.
That's what they called it. I'm just saying.
Suplex, like you flip them over. This is just you pick them up and you drop them. I don't know what these commentators are thinking.
Man.
Billy Jack Haynes and Ken Patera.
Oh, yeah.
Talk about an all-American team right there. They're in our main event versus Hercules Hernandez and King Harley Race, the legend
buddy.
Of the squared circle. Match ends in a DQ after Herc hits Billy Jerk with his chain. He puts that chain right upside Billy Jerk's head.
King Harley Race.
Match is over. DQ. And that's it for the rundown. How do you feel about it?
Sounds right. You know, just thinking about it.
What match were you most excited about that I talked about, would you say there? Like,
oh, can you pick one? You know?
It's hard. Turns out we're going to have to pick five, though. We got the five count coming up. That's where we pick five talking points, where we dig deeper into these episodes, these punishing episodes of 1980s professional wrestling, and then, we try to pull the diamonds out of the rough, or at least just shine a flashlight on the roughest of the rough.
Yeah.
Whichever way you want to go with it.
However.
What's your number one?
My number one is going to be however many Darrell cigarettes King Harley Race smoked before and after, immediately after the match.
You think he usually bought 3 packs before shows and he smoked a pack and a half before his match and a pack and a half after?
Now look here, Hercules, you and I are going to get out there. We're going to have this little match.
Impressive sideburns on that, man.
Cigarettes.
I'll tell you that much. I bet they smelled like nicotine.
We got more thoughts on that. We'll get to that later. That's not really.
That's not really. That's a fake number one.
I'm just shooting here, pal. I'm just having a good time.
That's a little fake out.
Just having a little good time. My first is going to be Sensational Sherry versus Rockin' Robin.
Yeah, all right.
At the Madison Square Garden.
MSG. Had a little split action going on.
Yeah.
What was it? Like half of the shit still from that Paris taping, and then like we got some MSG stuff
we
too.
We had at least three venues.
At least three
that
venues. Oh,
there
man.
We started in France.
Really
got that out of
the bottom of the barrel here.
We hit Madison Square Garden, and then
chopping up these house
shows.
We
were at the Boston Garden.
Oh God.
There might have been one other.
We're always
there.
Running Boston.
Yeah. Ugh. Sickening. But we're in good old
skin crawl.
Good old New York City, you know.
These vagabond shit.
Yeah. I'm thinking about
Gremlins 2, The New Batch.
I'm thinking about
When I think about New York, I think about Gremlins 2, The New Batch.
I was thinking about Springsteen's Philadelphia. I just like that song.
That's that AIDS song, right?
Yeah. Streets of Philadelphia.
That's a sad song.
That's probably like the last of Springsteen's like quiet mumble songs.
What about that song you made for The Wrestler?
Well, yeah, but that's kind of like folksy, like having a good time.
I don't remember how that one went.
Have you ever seen a one-trick pony?
That's really good.
You seen me.
There's a little movie that got like a lot of attention when it was out there, and I feel like it's just completely been forgotten. Who talks about The Wrestler these days?
And who? Why?
Maybe it's because Mickey Rourke's like attempted comeback with that movie didn't actually turn into a comeback. So,
and everybody's too
in
busy.
In retrospect, it doesn't mean much.
Everybody's too busy thinking about the movie that could have been had they kept with the original casting of Nick Cage.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. That's true. Of a
How
lot
come
of
you internet
though?
You internet dorks aren't talking about that time Darren Aronofsky and Nick Cage were at that Ring of Honor show? People stop talking about that.
I feel like
that's sad.
That's old Ring of Honor. Back when they used to do like just like real storylines where the wrestlers were mad at each other, and then they'd have like stiff, like cool matches.
Yeah, instead of flipping around and
nobody
having a good
cared
time.
About that shit.
Couple
yeah,
jokes,
now everybody is a
couple dick jokes.
Everybody is out there shooting memes in the ring, and
I tell you what, wrestling
chuckling,
fans
doing a lot of get a laughs.
As much as you wrestling fans hate the gays, you guys sure love male wrestlers playing with each other's peepers in the ring.
I think that might be changing. Actually, that might be one of the rare positive side effects
okay,
of all
good.
This weird.
Time.
Goofy shit that's happening in wrestling is that all the homophobia that's been rampant in these basement dwelling trolls is going away, and they're starting to learn a little bit of tolerance, just as long as the gay people are silly and into like Japanese cartoons like they are. Well, then it's cool.
Okay, well, now that it's getting over, we can start to hate it now. We can
start
a federation where it's like no gays, damn it. Yeah,
that's gonna be cool.
Old-fashioned southern wrestling.
Man show wrestling.
Oh, yeah.
We're going to get Adam Carolla to be like our ring announcer.
Big boobies or get out.
That's going to be great. Girls on trampolines bouncing next to our entrance ramp.
Speaking of girls, back to what we were going to talk about, which is Sherry and Robin.
You caught on to my ruse.
Yeah.
Trying to.
You did it, pal. You
not
wrangled
have to
me.
Talk about this wrestling.
Get me back in there. It was okay match. It was, we had a Sherry match a couple weeks ago that
we
was
did
pretty
indeed.
Decent.
Yeah.
And this one seemed to have the same problem where it just went on a little too long.
Way too long.
It was like really good.
Style women's wrestling.
Really good for a while.
They're
and then all of a sudden it was like,
doing all that stuff with like the hair beels and shit. Like not real wrestling, but just like the chick spots. They're only allowed to do really chick spots. So it's just.
I think Sensational Sherry, her wrestling style is very similar to Lex Luger's promo style, where it's like, this is pretty good. This is going to be all right. This is okay. Oh, it's still going. It's still trying a little bit. Still trying.
Going back
God.
To the same thing they were doing a minute ago.
Oh, this is still going. Oh, this is still going.
Yeah, a little bit less time on this, and then it would have been strong. Because Sherry is great. I mean, these girls in the 1980s, not quite the athletes of the current girls. They don't quite have the custom-made ring outfits. They're kind of just out there looking like weird hillbilly girls and
they just came from
just
like an aerobics class,
classes, just like THO flashing everywhere, big hair, hairspray, and like as far as just like giving people boners, it's all very solid. But
oh hell yeah, the boner work is phenomenal.
Translating to captivating wrestling, it's not quite doing the job.
The one positive we got is Brain's never-ending reluctance to accept women's wrestling, and he never gives concrete reasons as to why. It's just a blanket,
straight out says at the beginning, I don't want to be involved in women's wrestling.
Yeah, that's his reason. Like, there's no other reason than that.
Fair enough.
Straight up, doesn't want to be involved.
But yeah, Sherry, just like number one, my number one, just talking about Sherry, how everything she does in here is all the great shit that she was able to do also as a manager. Like, what's she doing? She's fucking taking big bumps.
Yep.
Other than she got drop kicked in the butt. Went ass over tea kettle
that
outside
really
of the
cool.
ring.
I like
and
that
then just
one.
Like once she got out there, she's whining to the crowd and
no
screaming
mats.
At him and they're hating it.
Hey, yeah. She takes that big spot over the top rope. I'm going to get on the soapbox for a minute.
Sure.
Takes that big dump over the top rope onto the floor. No mats, right?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, we just had a women's elimination.
Video of her taking a big dump.
Oh, hell yeah, dog. Mm-hmm. We just had that big women's elimination chamber match. And what did they have in the chamber this year?
I don't know.
Mats over the steel grates outside of the ring.
Well, that just makes it far less of an imposing structure, if you ask me.
Correct.
Jeez.
And then they left him down for the men's match.
Hmm.
What are they doing, man? It's not brutal.
People are whining about the brutality of the elimination chamber.
You never see that kind of pussy crap inside of the triple cage.
You know,
Dave Arquette's triple cage.
These guys, they're landing on this grating. It's cutting up their skin. It's hurting their backs. And quite frankly, just like the footing on them isn't good enough to do springboard flippy stuff. Like,
oh,
I was trying
true.
To get out here and do some gymnastics, man. And I need some traction down here so
that's
I could
true.
Do a springboard into a double Beal gainer, whatever.
Mm-hmm. Triple SoCal.
Ain't
going to
be none of that stuff in Man Show Wrestling. I'll
no
tell you
way,
right
man.
Now.
No way.
No flips, just fists, right?
Yeah.
Revival, once you guys get fired, that's coming soon. We're going to have you on our shows.
Oh, real soon.
Real soon. But yeah, Sherry, great at getting heat.
Mm-hmm.
Great at shrieking. Great at screaming. Every time she gets Bealed, she's yelling, her hair was getting pulled. She's a great heel. She really doesn't have a division to work with,
nope.
So there's no point in her being women's champion. So
It's
cool that they figured out, hey, let's scrap this women's division and keep Sherry around, though, and make her a manager, because she's one of the greatest fucking managers ever. Taking big bumps, doing a lot of shrieking, getting heat.
And she took some shots in the ring.
Oh, yeah. I heard
big bumps,
you
know
rumors.
What I'm saying? Huh?
I heard the rumors, but I didn't...
Taking big bumps?
I didn't know there was any proof of that.
Double entendre.
Cool. So, yeah, I guess both of us threw our number ones at that. That's how my list is going.
Yeah.
Because, you know, strangely enough, I didn't want to talk about that Sika and Special Delivery Jones match at all, where even the announcers were so bored during it that they just started making small talk.
Yeah.
Hey, Brain, you ever visited the Liberty Bell? This shit was in fucking Paris, and they're talking about seeing the sights when they go to fucking Philadelphia. Just like, what sandwiches they're going to be planning on eating the next few days.
Brain sounded like he didn't much care for Philly, and rightfully so.
Oh, yeah.
Because I mentioned the only good part about Philadelphia a couple minutes ago.
Well, I
Springsteen song.
The only good thing about Philadelphia is that it's not Boston.
Come down to Dunkin' every day. Grab a Corolla, have an extra large, three Parliaments, take a big dump. That's kind of the routine.
Ooh, well played.
Yeah. That's one point in their little notch over there if we're keeping score. We're not going to talk about that. We're going to move on because not even the announcers wanted to talk about that, and they're paid to talk about it. What's your number two?
My number two would be the British Bulldogs.
We're just ticking along.
Versus
ticking
Gino
right along through this thing.
Carabello and Brian Costello. Right before that, though, real quick, they're doing the whole...
Okay, I got a second, but just this has got to take a second.
Yeah. Hogan and Andre.
I got places to be.
Hogan and Andre feud, blah, blah, blah. I don't know what the lead up was.
All the recap.
But there was a great Brain line.
Recap of that feud.
Monsoon asks Brain something about what he's going to do, and Brain just, does the old slow your roll, Monsoon, and then offers up this chestnut. He who doesn't look out for himself usually don't do things.
That's almost sounds like a Tommy Shytown word
bit.
Of wisdom right there.
That's probably why it stuck with
Bobby
me so
the Brain
much.
Heenan spitting some, soothsaying gold right up there with our old friend Tommy Shytown's parable.
God rest his soul.
Why buy the map when you can walk the trail for free?
Yeah. And then forget his other famous
Kung Fu
saying.
Master wisdom right there.
I know Vanilla Ice. Quit yanking my dick. Do you want to meet the guy or not?
Did he really know Vanilla Ice?
I don't know anymore, man. But the whole Bulldogs thing, it was the match was meh.
King of Chicago.
The match wasn't that great, but Jesse Ventura's announcing was
fantastic. I wanted to talk about the announcing. This is my number two.
Yeah.
We can get into this, sure.
You got Vince being awful, just being like...
Terrible.
He just wants to be like... Okay, so you got the big storyline going where the Islanders and the Brain stole Matilda.
Matilda so being like, the British Bulldog's bulldog.
Correct.
It's so, not just like some old lady that got kidnapped.
Yeah. Bulldogs...
Make that clear.
Bulldogs are hurting. They're not their usual like fun bunch like, hey, it's good to see everybody. Here's a dog. We're going to go wrestle a match. They're like, we're angry. We want our dog.
Yeah.
You guys, you assholes are going to pay for it. It's not your fault, but we're taking it out on somebody.
You jobbers. And, you miserable jobbers.
Vince is just like, they're the Bulldogs. Everybody loves the Bulldogs. Jesse Ventura is like, I don't know, man. They don't look the same since they lost their dog. And, you know.
No. This is the opposite here.
This is the Bulldogs.
This is my number two. This is, there's a little bit of contention. Vince is the one who's pushing the issue that they don't look the same. But he's saying like, oh, they look depressed. I don't think they're going to be able to wrestle.
Oh, yeah,
so
that's
depressed.
Right. Yeah, he's saying they look depressed.
And meanwhile,
yeah.
They don't look depressed. They look vicious. They're just systematically destroying these people. Yeah. And Vince is just going into business for himself instead of watching the match and like
that's
calling
what
what's happening.
Thank you.
He's saying shit that makes no sense, being like, they're so depressed. They're not going to be like, they're killing these guys.
They're sad. They're sad guys.
If that's the storyline you're pushing, then book a match that like, you know, they're making mistakes and these jobbers are getting one over
right.
on them. But that's not what's happening. In the ring.
And Vince,
so then thankfully Jesse starts being like, no, Vince, you're wrong.
Let me teach you about wrestling.
I think it's actually making them madder, and they're looking more vicious, and they got more of a killer instinct in the ring because they're so mad about this dog.
Look at the way they're pulling people up before that three count just so they can keep beating them.
So Vince McMahon, head announcer and head booker and, you know, head of the company, he's writing all these storylines, needs his fucking color guy, Jesse Ventura, to correct him and be like, no, let's call what's happening in the ring. That's not what this storyline is.
Yeah.
Let's talk about what the storyline actually is on the camera so that the audience isn't just watching this being like, what the fuck's Vince McMahon talking about?
That looks sad.
What a dumb bimbo.
Vince McMahon's just
a dumb bimbo.
I tell you what, if I lost my dog, I'd be sad.
I say, Jesse Ventura, at this point in his career, he's got a good head on him. He's making a lot of good points. Who would know that he would go absolutely batshit crazy later on in his life and start living in the woods and talking about like 9/11 conspiracies and shit?
Well, he was Navy SEAL. I mean...
Yeah.
He went through some shit.
But Matilda's back at the end of this match,
well,
I think, maybe.
Possibly back.
You know, Bobby comes out. He's got some dog food. They got some invisible dogs.
Yeah, I really like that.
That old mime routine where they got the dog leash with the invisible dog on it.
Brain's just going wild, like
slapping
around.
He tells these big jacked up British idiots, like, you got to go in the back. Cause,
you want
maybe,
your dog?
Maybe Jack Tunney's got some news about where your dog is, you big dum-dums.
He's slapping around that contract. He's like, look. Ink's not even dry yet. Islanders are reinstated.
Very cocky. They're no longer suspended. I feel like he knows something about this dog that we don't.
You go on. You get out of here.
Perhaps this is all going to come to a head at the Rumble Royal.
Possibly at the Rumble Royal. I don't know. It's not a definite, though.
We'll see how that's going to suss out for us.
I liked when they left the segment and went back to the studio.
Mm-hmm.
Monsoon asking the Brain about it. And Brain was like, look, you know, I was just sitting at home. Minding my own business. I get an anonymous phone call.
Story of my life.
With a voice I don't recognize being like, hey, you know, you want to know where this dog is?
Yeah.
I know where the dog is. And, you know, he passed that phone number on to
Jack Tunney. So many twists and turns to this dog story.
He's like, Jack Tunney here. I found a guy. That's nice of him. He's a good guy.
I'm really surprised they didn't use this to, like, you know, debut some kind of detective character. A real Philip Marlowe type, or maybe like a Columbo type. They kind of
that'd be nice.
Yeah, gravelly voiced guy in a trench coat, smoking a pipe. Number three. This is great. This is very time efficient when we just keep wanting to talk about the same shit because there's so little to talk about.
I'm gonna talk number three.
I can't wait. I'm waiting here with bated breath.
This was exciting. WWF did their own version. Of a Jim Crockett's World Championship Wrestling segment.
Okay, tell me more.
Well,
like I said, I haven't watched this for 2 weeks.
They've got.
It wasn't that engaging the first time I watched it.
They have their big pay-per-view coming up.
Mm-hmm.
Just give me a chance, because I'm just trying to try.
Well, not a pay-per-view. This
here.
First one, it's
oh,
the,
that's right. It's
a special on USA so far.
I'm going to try to get through all the nonsense I've written down here, which isn't much, but it's a lot.
Okay, let's hear about it.
So we got the Royal Rumble coming up. So they cut
Rumble
to,
Royal, please.
Exactly. They cut to a special report with Mean Gene.
Mm-hmm.
And he looks at the camera and he's like, hey, everybody's talking Gene about it this Sunday. It's happening. And he says specifically, The Royal Rumble. And then immediately
he
says it
like mad too, yeah. Like somebody had been correcting him and he's like, okay,
and
is
then,
that it?
And then
I got it right, okay.
And then immediately says, Rumble Royal, whatever.
Well, okay, this is specifically one of my points. This is going to be my number three. I was shocked that he called it the Royal Rumble.
And then
after all these weeks of him calling it the Rumble Royal, but he called it the Royal Rumble twice, actually. So I was like, ooh, yeah. Then the third time he called it the Rumble Royal again. So two out of three times. This episode.
So
he almost got it.
Well, if you listen to him, he goes at the Royal Rumble and then like follows it up like as a fuck you, like
yeah.
The Royal Rumble, and then like says under his breath,
right?
The Rumble Royal or whatever. Like, I don't even give a fuck about what this thing is.
I think he does give a fuck, though. I think he is really mad. He thinks it should be the Rumble Royal.
You guys are naming it the wrong thing.
The Royal Rumble makes no sense, but Rumble Royal is something that totally makes sense.
So he interviews...
his gin breath. I felt like I could smell it through the TV.
Yeah.
It was like burning my eyebrows.
Okay, well, what am I drinking? What do you got?
I got a bottle of scotch my uncle gave me. Hennigan's. It's been there 2 years. I've been using it as a paint thinner. All right. I don't smell anything.
Okay, we're too close to the bottle.
Yeah.
George.
Come on up.
That is damn good scotch. I gotta do a commercial for this stuff. Mmm. Boy, that Hennigan goes down smooth. And afterwards, you don't even smell. That's right, folks. I just had 3 shots of Hennigan's and I don't smell. Imagine, you can walk around drunk all day. That's Hennigan's. No smell, no tell, scotch.
And he's drinking like bellows. It's not even good stuff.
You got a big job interview and you're a little nervous? Well, throw back a couple of shots of Hennigan's and you'll be as loose as a goose and ready to roll in no time. And because it's odorless, why, it'll be our little secret.
H-E-N-N-R.
Kramer. Yeah, that'll do.
So he gets Dino Bravo and Frenchie Martin out there.
Oh, fuck.
And
who's producing this show?
Keeps calling it Rumble Royal again, to which... You know, breaks
just
my brain.
A little silent protest.
Yeah, and then they're like...
Not silent, verbal protest, I guess.
We're going to talk about everybody's favorite thing and WCW's favorite thing, the bench press.
Got to have dueling bench press.
Yeah. So this goes on for a while, and then they go to commercial, and then they come back from commercial for a special report, and this one's with, what's the other guy, Greg or DeGeorge or whatever his name?
It's not Sean Mooney?
No, it was Greg DeGeorge
week,
I think. Either way.
Getting my ears mixed up.
It's like, oh, special report. What are we going to...
It's that Ken doll-looking little fucking wiener that Vince McMahon always has one of them on his roster.
Correct.
Just generic little white guy in a suit.
It's like, oh, we just talked about the Rumble Royal and the
looking
bench press.
Looking at you, Todd Pettengill.
What are we going to talk about now that we're back from commercial and this is a completely different segment?
Mm-hmm.
It's Dino Bravo and Frenchie Martin.
That's
to talk about the bench press
exactly
again.
Exactly what I wanted to bitch about. Fucking two Dino and Frenchie. Who is producing this shit?
What is going
Who is
on
in charge
here,
of this
man?
Show? This show is a shit show. And it's Bruce Pritchard.
All
I know
over
that
the
it's
map.
You, Bruce Pritchard.
It's garbage. It's
brother
bullshit.
Love. You're fucking ooh. How much fucking weed were they smoking this week when they just fucking cut this show together with like...
It makes no sense. So the special report keeps going. We get the Glamour Girls and Jimmy Hart. And the Glamour Girls...
Oh, man.
Looking about 64 years old.
This is the thing about them trying to do this women's division back then. Like, they're not athletes compared to the girls they got now these days. Like, they're 1/4 of the athletes. They're not... It's not even that they're not attractive like the girls they had like 10 years ago.
Yeah.
It was all like underwear models or whatever. It's like, it'd be one thing if they just had girls that were athletic, but like frumpy looking, or like girls that were really hot, but not athletic. But these girls aren't even frumpy looking and unathletic. They're also grandmas.
Yeah.
Like their entire roster looks like they could be people's, not well, looks like, probably are people's grandmas.
It's a mix, man. Because they also show the Jumping Bomb Angels, who are from Japan.
Sure,
and they're,
sure.
They're young,
real
nice
women's
Asian
wrestlers.
Girls.
Like, there was real women's wrestling going on
right.
in Japan
and
at this
and
point.
I'm saying, you get
and they're just in for, like, a short-term thing.
It's
that North American women's right. wrestling, though. What even was it?
Well, it's two things. It's one category or the other. And there's, like you said, there's a handful of them that are, like, real wrestlers or trying to be wrestlers. Like your Rockin' Robin and your Sensational Sherry.
Yeah, that's Grizzly Smith's daughter, right?
Yeah.
So she's just, you know, yeah. little hillbilly chick, grew up right. in the business, probably had no other options. Like, this is all I know, so I'm going to be a wrestler.
There's a couple of these girls, and they're younger girls, and they're not like supermodels, but they're not like...
Yeah, Rockin' Robin.
Terrible.
Right.
They're just...
I'd take her behind the dumpster.
Yeah, high sixes, low sevens. Nothing wrong with that, you know?
Nothing wrong with that.
Here they are. And then... So there's a handful of them, and then they're like, well, we got to round out the rest of this roster. What should we do? What about that one chick that used to wrestle like 10, 15
Call up
years ago?
Fabulous Moolah and have her yeah. bring in a car full of her old lady friends.
Yeah, and that's the rest of them. It's
These
nuts,
poor,
man.
Poor, poor women living in Moolah's weird whorehouse, turning tricks for like just like terrible undercard spots on these throwaway yeah. shows. Like, ooh, what was women's wrestling? It was... One of the sleaziest, most depressing things
absolutely.
That ever existed up until very recently.
You know, there's this whole, you know, the, what's the me, whatever movement, Me Too.
Me Too, hashtag Me Too. Yeah.
So that's going on, and like we're finally finding out like how sleazy like Hollywood was to women.
Sure.
I want to know what was going on to women in wrestling for all those years.
It's all out there. Fabulous Moolah was essentially just a pimp. She's brought these girls in, like, just, like, made them fucking blow promoters and shit, so like, and then took just, like, huge cuts of all their fucking money when she got them on these shows. And that's all women's wrestling was. It was just, there was one or two girls who fucking Moolah hated because they were real chicks trying to, like, be real wrestlers. And then there was Moolah's girls who were just, like, runaways and drug addicts and shit that she'd corral in, tell them she was going to make them stars, and then exploit them.
She was the El Swearingen.
Yeah, she's essentially Fabulous Moolah. That's a very good like comparison right there. Was the not even Swearingen though. She was probably like the more evil whorehouse owner from across the street.
Yeah.
Like I got
Powers Booth.
I think Mae Young was probably
the
El.
She was the Powers Booth.
Yeah.
You want a blowjob while I talk to you?
No.
I wasn't offering it personally.
You're gonna be a big star, you see. I'm gonna bring you in.
Gross, gross shit going on. They should be ashamed of the fact that they let it go on for so long, and they put Fabulous Moolah in their goddamn Hall of Fame, which is just full of pimps and scumbags, and they're gonna act like, oh, we can't let China in because she got some dicks up her ass in a porno.
Oh, you talking?
Give me a break.
You're talking about pimps like
Give
Godfather.
Me a break.
Godfather's in there, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Fucking smoking fatties and, I don't know, what did he say?
Boombaladdies.
Ho-train.
Yeah. Ho-train's still a funny line, and people should use it more often.
Yeah, I'm not really upset. Like, the Pro Wrestling Hall of Fame should be full of nothing but just, like, weird sleazebags and criminals and just,
when
like,
we get a, when we get a,
sex perverts and...
When we get a long... group of women in the old Hooskow in Cobb County.
Mm-hmm.
I like to call them the Ho Train.
Oh yeah, that's fun.
Hey, check out the Ho Train.
You gotta degrade these people.
Yeah, that's good to do. It's good to
that's
do.
Good to do.
People aren't real people. Don't judge me. So Jumping Bombs cut a promo as well. Blah blah blah. They cut back to the Brain. He said some really racist stuff, and he's like, "I know what they said."
That's my next point.
They want to know how many egg rolls you want?
Okay,
monsoon?
Yeah. This is my number four. I guess I'm up to is just we talk a lot about the casual racism of '80s pro wrestling, and we usually get one or two things every episode. But this episode was drenched with it, soaked in it. There was racism in almost every segment, and here at this point. It was probably the peak of it where Bobby the Brain Heenan was making Chinese restaurant jokes about two Japanese girls.
And then Gorilla tries to talk about where they're from, to which the Brain says, Squid City.
Squid City. It's pretty good. These people, they're eating all these weird foods that we can't... Sushi, where I come from. Call that bait.
Call that bait.
So, yeah, back to that 1980s and also early 90s, just a truth, that just fucking scientific truth of sushi's weird, people are eating it, and it's funny to talk about. Like, I'm going to make sushi jokes all day, every day.
All day?
That was 80s comedians, bread and butter. But also going back into that big eight-man tag, just think putting on such like an ominous voice during his ring announcing. Like, he was talking like the Fink, normally.
Yeah.
And then he announced the conquistadors, and to try to get them over his heels, he announced, oh, the conquistadors from somewhere in Latin America. It's like they're just trying to get these people over his heels for being from a foreign country, but were so fucking racist they couldn't even be bothered to crack open a fucking encyclopedia and think of the name of a Latin American country. Motherfuckers can't even name a Latin American country when pressed. So
they're like, clearly
somewhere in Latin America.
They're like clearly 2 6-foot tall white dudes in masks.
Just probably.
And they're just like, what are you? Where are these guys going to be? They're Mexican or something.
Maybe
right?
That was,
well, I don't know. Well,
the
where
big
are they
eight man
from?
Tag, is that
I,
the
I
one? Is that the one that came from the Boston Garden? Is that why they were pushing so hard on the racist
could've
angle
been.
To try
could've
to get
been.
Cheers out of this crowd? Because
there's a couple of them from the
when
from
the
BG.
When the whole Russian national anthem thing was getting sang, there was a great guy in a red cowboy hat just pounding on the guardrail and screaming, just like legit angry. One of those classic old "I'm taking this shit seriously" fans.
We're
like,
in the midst of a cold war.
Not having a good time. Like, just really think that this shit is real, fucking fans. And just a big old red cowboy hat, and I loved him.
Let me tell you what, bro. We're still in a cold war. People just don't know about it.
We're in a cyber war now. It's gone into the realm of the hackers.
I thought that ended.
The crackers and the hackers.
I thought that ended once that...
we got all these elite Russian trolls out there.
Once that Joseph Gordon-Levin movie came out.
A worm and a virus? The plot thickens.
Hide the planet! Hide the planet!
Shut up and get in the car!
That's just a little of my Matthew Lillard. What JGL thing are you talking about?
He had that movie where he was like Snowden. Is that Snowden? Or am I thinking of Snow Day?
Was he in Snow Day? Been in a Snowden movie. That's sort of ringing some bell. I was thinking about Premium Rush, where he's the bike messenger.
Oh, yeah.
And he's got to evade Michael Shannon, who's coming after him. Mm. That was a real good movie.
I tell you what,
underrated. If you haven't seen Premium Rush, go out there. Great chase scenes, great just action editing, like Michael Shannon being an amazing bad guy.
Also, if you have the choice to watch Snowden or Snow Day, watch Snow Day.
Oh, Snow Day is a great film.
That's just a good movie. It's just a good movie.
Iggy Pop's in that shit.
Yeah.
I tell you, speaking of these Oscars, saw a picture on the internet today of Michael Shannon last night.
Ooh. Was he there? Did they let him in?
He was in that, The Shape of Water, the Guillermo del Toro movie
that won
Best Picture.
He was also in that big Tesla movie.
Yeah, sure. But the movie he was in won Best Picture, The Shape of Water.
Right.
I saw pictures of him, and he was not at the Oscars. He was at the Old Town Ale House, that fucking dive bar in the Viagra Triangle, and he was watching the Oscars.
Chicago?
Yep, on a little TV. No audio, the jukebox on, just listening to jukebox tunes, just drinking beers and just watching the Oscars out of the corner of his eyes. And man, these pictures looked great. I was like, God damn, I wish I had happened upon the Old Town Ale House last night so I could have watched the fucking Oscars with Michael Shannon halfway, but not really caring about him. That shit's badass.
I would just sit next to him and no sell him.
Uh-huh.
Like, be like, I don't know who you are. Because he's just going to nudge you and be like, hey, this guy here. And then try to give you some juicy tidbit about it, or a little behind the scenes dirt on him. And you just be like, yeah, that's great, pal. I don't know who you are.
Listen, hit the bricks.
Yeah.
I don't know. There's a lot of weirdos in that bar.
I feel like
I got to commiserate with Michael Shannon about all the old drunks around us.
I feel like he really is his character in Bug.
Oh, yeah. He's got all this stuff under his... He did look like he was... Had some goatee action with some grown out 5 o'clock show.
What
the rest
was he
of
doing
them like
Chicago?
Longer hair. Well, he's an old Chicago theater fucking guy.
Oh,
he came up through all that shit. I don't know. I don't know if he kind of lives here every once in a while or whatever. But that certainly his
God
roots are in in the theater of this town, for sure.
And then he's like, I'm going to come back home and hang out in the Viagra Triangle.
That's a weird, gross bar.
That's a gross area, that area.
Well, yeah, unless you want to pick up some divorcees, and then suddenly it's the land of opportunity. Nothing wrong with that at all.
Real quick thing. Back to the bench press.
Oh, yeah, why don't we? They talked about it 5 or 6 times, so we should at least cover it 3 or 4.
It dawned on me. You got Mean Gene saying the Rumble Royal. So he's saying the wrong name.
Rumble
over and over,
Royal.
Right? And they're all like giving like bullshit explanations of the rules for the match.
Mm-hmm.
No one's really like invested in it.
Unproven concept.
Right. That's what I'm saying. Do you
big brainchild of Pat Patterson?
Right?
Vince at this point doesn't really think it's a good idea.
There you go. So I'm saying like Patterson's like, no, this is going to be great. And Vince is just like incredulous to it. Just like, whatever. We'll do a bench press.
Mm-hmm.
That'll be what we'll sell.
That's exactly what's happening.
Bench press.
Vince is
people
hedging
want
his
muscles.
Bets.
You want to see people lift weights.
Uh-huh. He doesn't think this Rumble Royal thing is going to fucking pan
out.
Sounds dumb.
Yeah.
So what are you going to do on there? Put a big
give
beefy
people what they
dude out
see.
There and have him lift heavy stuff. Because that makes for good television.
It's Dino Bravo. Who's he lifting weights against?
He's not lifting weights against anybody. This
oh,
is
just,
not
okay.
like the
it's
WCW
like
the, thing where there's a competition. He's just trying to break the world record. And he's claimed that he's going to break the world record.
Stupid.
Live at the Rumble Royal.
I mean, it's a great idea. It's a great idea.
Like I predicted, we're going to get into that bunkhouse stampede next weekend. I've predicted that the bench press competition will be the most boring part of that show. I've also predicted that this Dino Bravo bench press world record shattering will be the most boring part. We'll see how it hashes out.
In all fairness.
We'll see how it hashes out.
Everything Dino Bravo does is the most boring part.
I liked how he showed up in the movie Encino Man and watching his matches taught Brendan Fraser how to protect himself when he was getting picked on by that cool bully who always went, shush, shush.
Forget it. Rom wouldn't piss on your gums if your teeth were on fire.
Yeah, she would.
Shush! Hush, please!
I think that was one of the DeLuise kids.
Yeah, not chubby like son. He had like a real... He was the Cody Rhodes to Peter DeLuise's Dustin Rhodes.
I want to say there's 3 of them.
There's 3 of them?
Well, because there's the one that was in 21 Jump
That's
Street.
That's Peter DeLuise.
There's the one that was in Encino Man that we just talked about. And then one of them, maybe it is Peter DeLuise that shows up back to our girl Selena Gomez.
Mm-hmm.
She was in Wizards of Waverly Place.
Don't have enough nice things to say about her.
On Disney.
Uh-huh.
One of the DeLuises played her father. In that.
Oh.
Yeah.
Never heard of a third one.
But I want to say there is
I'd like to hear that it was Peter, because he didn't really do much after that highs of 21 Jump Street. I'd like to hear that he got some of that Disney paycheck later on.
I hope it's not him, because the one that's in this one is like fat and balding.
Oh, well, he was definitely going that way, clearly.
Probably is him. We'll bing it later.
I'm going to definitely bing in that.
Who's up? Me? You?
We got whatever our number 5s, I think.
Well, you know what my 5's going to be.
What's your 5?
Is it the same as yours?
I don't know. Let's see.
Come on. Who's left on the show?
I mean, the big main event. I want to talk about Harley Race.
Okay. I want to talk about Billy Jack Haynes.
Okay. So we're in the same little ballpark here talking about the big tag team main event match.
Oh, there's somebody else in that match I want to talk about.
Well, let's get to it. Is it Ken Patera?
What a piece of shit.
The whole match?
No, Ken Patera.
Oh, yeah. He's I like his Nacho Libre hair.
I got Patera looks like an asshole. That's my first note.
Uh-huh.
Second, followed up by Patera looks like a bodybuilding Richard Simmons.
Definitely. What do I got down here? I know I got something about... Patera looks like someone hit Richard Simmons with gamma rays. That's what I wrote down right here in my notes. So
there
you
go. That's why we've been such good friends for all these years.
Excellent!
Also, this match was dedicated to Tommy Vincent, who recently died.
Oh, God.
The announcer told us, so RIPD Tommy Vincent, whoever you are.
Did he have CTE?
Shitty filler tag match dedicated to your life, so congratulations there.
Patera. Just awful. I don't know why. Why was he a thing?
Well, he was an Olympian, he had Olympic credentials, so, you know, Vince looking for some of that crossover appeal.
This wasn't it. He was not the guy.
It certainly was not it.
This whole match, I was just like, man, I wish it was Billy Jack and his cousin.
Oh, yeah, Billy Jack and his cousin had some great chemistry that one time we saw them. They were both from Oregon. You know, they've been fussing and feuding with everybody for years and years. A lot of chemistry going on there.
I'll give WWF their credit. They really play up Billy Jack's Oregon heritage, and they let him.
He's got the word Oregon on every single piece of gear that he owns.
But not only that, they let him wrestle in the green and yellow University of Oregon colors.
The Ducks from Eugene, man.
And he's got the state of Oregon, like the physical state, on his
boots
now.
Loves Oregon. That man loves Oregon.
But the one thing that they're not playing up, which they should be, is the second half of that.
The ninja aspect of his Oregon ninja gimmick. Not so kinda much talk about unique. His zen fucking, mindset and the way he's using his hands to karate chop down big trees out there in the forests of Oregon. Yeah, they're missing that because I think Vince is too blinded by the man's physique.
Yeah.
So he's not.
Well, they're probably doing a lot of cocaine together.
Technique. I kind of just talking about this. I just want to talk about how boring and bad the match was.
Yeah.
How boring and bad all these matches are because of the limitations of this WWF style showing where you just got big guys and they clubber each other and then they pose and then they clubber and they pose. And by fucking just a little bit of throw it up there, just like the opposite of that, you got Harley Race, NWA legend, in this match at 85 years old, and he's just fucking out bumping all these people, like just working his ass off for no reason, like diving headbutts, like over the fucking ropes, like just all sorts of crazy shit.
Yeah,
just fucking no reason for it, but that's just how he came up working that southern style of wrestling where you hit the mat hard, you hit the ropes hard, you work a body part, you try to get heat, you try to just like stay on something and hammer it and get the people. You don't just forearm people and pose. And you know, there's pluses and minuses to both styles, but this show in particular with all these boring matches just really showed how you need a little bit of this southern wrestling in there every once in a while. Because this
southern wrestling,
if all you got's this northern style, it's all just Vince's big men and just like they're big personas and fucking nothing doing between the ropes. Like, it gets so boring.
That's something I noticed this week in particular. And we knock WCW NWA all the time because they don't really know what they're doing and everything's all over the place.
What a mess.
But even in their mess, WCW, NWA, they have like a sense of urgency.
Yeah.
Like, the shit's important.
These guys in the ring, they're trying to win their matches. They're trying to win their matches.
But it's important. And WWF is just like, no, we're having a good time. It's all right. We're having a good time. And then every once in a while, they're like, whoa, hold on now. I'm a little upset with you. But it's few and far between.
King Harley.
How about that blonde hair on that super, super pale body?
Big, poofy blonde afro, but he outworked all these guys that are one quarter of his fucking age.
You want to make a deal?
What's up, yeah.
Because I was just going to compare and contrast, but I'm going to take it a little step further here. I got some sweet ink. You don't have any ink,
no.
You know?
Tattoos are for hillbillies.
Yeah, except for my sweet gummo commemorative tattoos.
Yeah, they're definitely bucking that trend of tattoos being for hillbillies.
No. Yeah, it's all class.
Maybe if I go like get in there and also, but like I just do like a different Harmony Korine movie.
Well,
like I start getting some
Julianne Donkey Boy tattoos. That would be nice for you.
Maybe like a nice Trash Humpers back piece or something.
Yeah. I'm going to
join the club.
I got an idea for you.
Okay.
I will get all of Billy Jack Haynes' prison tattoos.
Oh, wow.
If you get all of Harley Race's prison tattoos.
I feel like I haven't paid much attention, but I gotta imagine he's just got like old school like anchors and like
mom
and a heart
and
stuff
like
that.
Daggers and
I got no problem with that.
But like it's all like
these are all things I can just probably get out of like those gumball machines got in like the fucking foyers of Walmarts.
But it's all like nasty forearm stuff where you don't try to hide anything.
No. And put it out there for the world to see.
Yeah, you don't. It was before the days of like these hipsters and people's getting their full sleeves. You know, like, oh, I got a tattoo all the way down my arm. No, you just got like one or two important things that you just boom, you show it right off.
I was a sailor, and I love my mom.
Yeah, Popeye was cool.
He was a sailor man. I'm not sure about his parentage. Never really saw a mom around that he loved. He seemed a little bit adrift. I'm thinking he might have had some issues with his parents. Maybe they died at an early age. I don't know. Was Popeye an orphan?
I think so. Might have been.
That's a sad story.
I'll have to watch the Robin Williams film again.
Oh, yeah. That's
Oliver Stone.
No, Robert Altman directed.
Oh, Robert Altman. That's right. I'm sorry.
Yeah, I tried to watch that for the first time in like 20 years. Like,
I bet that was terrible for you.
Fairly recently,
Altman did MASH, right?
Yes,
he did Nashville.
The Long Goodbye, one of my favorite films.
I love Nashville.
Oh, wow, so we're Robert Altman fans, but not fans of Popeye. It turns out. I get what he was going for, but I was just like, not for me, not for me.
Who played Bluto in that?
I don't John think Goodman? I got that far into it.
If it was made 10 years later,
it definitely would have been John Goodman, for sure.
We forgot about one of the worst parts of this match.
No, was it the whole port where they were just working heat on Hercules Hernandez for 10 minutes, even though Hernandez was the heel in the match and he should have been the one working heat on somebody?
Yeah, well, there's that. But I was thinking about the big, big hot tag to Ken Patera. They isolate...
G-Man House of Fire.
They isolate Billy Jack Haynes for quite a good time.
That guy's
got
a big head, Billy Jack
Finally.
Haynes.
That was one of my other points.
One of the biggest heads you've ever seen.
He was laying on the ground rolling around, and I realized he looked like a grown-up bearded Dustin from Stranger Things.
Oh, yeah, I could see that for sure.
Yeah,
he hit
really
that kid with gamma rays.
Yeah. Either way, he finally gets to his corner, and he tags in Big Kenny P, and then... Kenny P, everybody's like, yeah, come on, like, this is it, he's gonna get it, boom, hot tag, and he comes in and just throws like two of the limp-wristedest right hands I've ever seen, and then just like gets taken down.
That's his patented sweat into the oldies forearm.
So bad. He's so bad.
Yeah, he sucks. The show sucked.
It was bad.
Hopefully the Royal Rumble is gonna be a great show. You're going to take the taste of this show out of our mouths.
Also, whenever you guys want to start writing in with thank yous to the two of us for suffering through this shit and telling you about it.
Or maybe like just get well soon cards I'd like.
Be better, yeah.
I heard that your life sucks. Get well soon.
Enjoy this burn CD of Angela, a.k.a. the theme to Taxi.
There's no way anyone can enjoy that.
Nate, do me a favor.
Mm-hmm.
Cue it up.
Okay.
Play it out.
Yep.
As we head to these commercials.
Promotional consideration paid for by the following.
I wonder what I'd look like if I could just lose 30 pounds.
Well, you don't have to wonder anymore.
Who are you?
I'm you, Peter DeLuise, after the Ultra Slim Fast plan. I lost 40 pounds in 4 months.
You did? I mean, I did?
It was easy.
I had a delicious shake for breakfast, another for lunch, and then a wholesome dinner. Let me try that. Mmm, tasty. But can a shake really help me lose all that weight?
Hey, I'm proof, and you big guy.
A history.
Ultra Slim Fast. Give us a week, and we'll help take off the weight.
What girl's gonna go for me with a body like this?
Hang in there, Tom. I'm you 2 years from now, because you're drinking milk and working out.
Well, I'm not changing so far.
But milk's at work inside you.
Oh, yeah?
And tomorrow the difference can show.
All that protein for muscle and calcium for bones.
But I'm still a skinny bench warmer.
Hey, if the sight of yourself at 18 doesn't convince you, Tom, listen to your senior year girlfriend.
Hi, Tom. I'm waiting.
Milk. It does a body good.
I was trying to think about like a Pearl Jam baby oil and blow to do.
Got you early. I'm just going to go into it right now. Just,
like a
3-count spoken microphones today.
Ooh, when we unleash the podcast.
I still want to keep the meshed his teeth and bit the recessed lady's breast line.
Oh,
though.
Hell yeah.
That's the same. Either way, you're talking 3 counts or you're talking disturbed little boys. I'm still meshing my teeth and biting the recessed lady's breast. Oh, how could I forget?
Hell yeah.
Hit me with a surprise number 3.
Did you have a
favorite 80s tag team? Was the Conquistadors. Nobody liked them.
Spoiler alert, bro.
Nobody liked them.
But Matt did. did you have a recess lady?
I did not have a recess lady. We were just brought out by our normal teachers for recess. They had to pull double duty, I guess. Except I remember 5th grade, I had a pregnant teacher, Mrs. Carney, and she would pump her breasts when we were out of recess, and she warned us, like, hey, I'm going to be doing this when we're out of recess. So,
how about giving me a boner alert?
Don't
next
be barging
time, bro.
Into this room or whatever. And she had like a little like paper thing like blocking the window. Yeah. Like people would know, like, hey, don't come in here. I'm pumping my titties. And then like after we got back from recess, we'd all just like be staring at the breast pump, like sitting on her desk, and just like
dare you to sniff it.
There it is. It happened. I made her cry when she overheard me here saying that her eco fair that she put together sucked.
Oh.
There was a lot of
pregnancy
hormones running through that lady. She was
floating through the veins.
Yeah, she was a hair trigger. Just a bomb ready to go off at any point, that woman.
Are we talking about something else?
No, I don't think so. All right,
that's going to do it this week. Oh, tag teams.
3-count.
Back again.
Last time we were here, talked about our favorite tag teams when we were little kids. Who was our favorite chick growing up?
Oh, yeah.
This time we're going to lay down, flip it, and reverse it. Still talking about...
Is your reminiscent brand, yep.
Still talking about those 80s tag teams, but what are our favorites right now? As to put like another flavor on it, I wanted to look at it from a different angle. Not who did you like when you were a stupid little kid who didn't know nothing. Now that you're a wise old sage and you can speak truth to power about what's good about pro wrestling from an educated standpoint.
Number one, smoking guns.
Who do you like when you look back to that era, that 1980s era going up? You know, we've got our NBA Jam rule that the 80s bleeded into the 90s until 1993 when NBA Jam was released and then the 90s officially started. In that era, you got 3 tag teams that you love. We're going to talk about who they are.
Can I go off topic for just a second? Because I just
right
said,
in a minute.
I just said...
every time we make a little bit of progress on this, and we just
I know,
get derailed.
But I just said smoking guns, and it made me think of a great show idea.
Oh, okay.
Maybe one show, we just get wasted, and we watch the entire...
That's not all your ideas start.
That's all right.
I'm noticing a pattern.
We find out however much is on the network, and we watch all of the Brawl for All challenge.
Whoa, gross.
Just watch the whole thing in one sitting.
I gotta tell you.
And then talk about it.
I'm gonna have to start seeing a therapist and get some sort of like psychosomatic drugs in here. Something to level me out before I even try that shit. Cause
I'm ready,
if
man.
If there's anything that's gonna send me in a tailspin, it's reliving the Brawl for All.
We'll just have the theme from Taxi playing the whole time.
Probably gonna do Suicide as Pain.
All right,
we gotta go full on MASH theme song if we're doing that.
Are we gonna do the instrumental or the one with words?
The one with words I find to be far more haunting.
And I can believe it.
It's actually sang by a ghost choir, as far as I know.
I'm suicide is painless.
Oh my god.
It takes on many faces. It's a weird
song. Picturing all that weird brown foliage in the opening credits of wherever they pretended like they were. That was Korea.
We can talk about
fucking TV show.
We can talk about tag teams, and this kind of sets it up. I'm going to give you a little thing here. As a young child,
the segue, Matto.
As a young child, I hated the TV show MASH.
As all young children of the era did.
And then I grew up.
Because it came on right after the real shows, so you'd have to try and hurry up and switch the channel before you heard the first fucking notes of that depressing, depressing song.
As I got older.
And then all that snide adult humor. Ugh, MASH.
As I got older, I realized how awful and daunting life can be.
Mm-hmm.
And I grew to like
Boy,
MASH.
Boy, howdy. No.
Yeah.
The turns you?
Yeah, I can watch MASH all day.
MASH?
Yep. I can watch it. And just like I used to hate a tag team, especially on account of how much my older brother liked them, I can watch it now as an adult and say, man, these guys were great heels.
That's
and
why
we talked about it last week.
That's why I made that t-shirt, that Ted was right t-shirt.
Ted
and I've
was
been
right.
Wearing it around, wearing around everywhere.
Heart Foundation were a couple of good bad dudes.
Oh, yeah.
Real good
that
bad
dudes.
That
was one of my picks from last week as a child.
Yep.
Me and Ted were
copacetic. I hated them. I did not like them, but that's because they were good guys when I could remember.
Mm-hmm.
But now that I get to go back,
stroking goatees
as an adult,
putting sunglasses on babies' heads.
Yeah, it's so much cooler when you're stroking your goatee because you hate everybody.
Mm-hmm.
And it's so much cooler when you're not giving your sunglasses to people.
No, I gotta keep these.
Yeah. They were cool, man.
The sun glinting off the snow up there in Calgary. I'm going to go blind if I don't have my sunglasses on.
They were the best bad guys.
Oh, yeah, real good.
They were up there.
Slimy, just gross Bret Hart and just like big, burly, smelly Jim Neidhart.
They were kind of like, I don't know, the Arn Anderson and Tully.
Yeah, the Pinky and the Brain
of WWF. They were cool, you know, they knew how to talk shit, but they still got it done in the ring.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they could cheat, but they could still beat you because they were just good at fighting. They were great.
And they had the Mouth of the South, week after week just realizing more and more is our favorite manager of all time.
Yeah, and he wrestled or
one of his first
high-profile
gigs there in WWF. I guess, you know, just like, you know, sometimes these people get paired with each other and it's just all like whatever the writers tell you or whatever. And sometimes a little bit of reality bleeds into this fantasy. And from what I understand, Jimmy Hart kind of was a real manager to the Glamour Girls.
Oh.
What was it? Leilani Kai was one of them. The other one was Judy whatever. I don't know. Either way, I hear that he approached them one day and was just like, you know, I've been watching your matches. Like, I like the way you guys work as a team, but, like, you're boring to look at. Like, there's nothing going on here, so.
At all.
How about I become your manager? We're going to dye all your fucking hair just, like, trash ball blonde.
Bleach blonde. Kelly Bundy blonde.
Put you in, like, black and gold singlets and give you fur coats, and you're going to have a gimmick, and we're going to start doing it that way. And Jimmy Hart really did put them together visually as a package and kind of get them on WWF television.
He's
a
good dude.
Yeah, he's looking out for not the youth because these women were in their 60s, but he's, you know, he's looking out for everyone.
Is that your first pick, the Glamour Girls?
My number three is the British Bulldogs.
I know you like them.
I'm not talking about, you know, this 1988 British Bulldogs we've been watching where they both just look like you kind of plugged a fucking bicycle pump up their ass and just pumped them up until they were about ready to burst and can't really move because they're so muscle-bound and Dynamite's fucking spine so shattered. I'm talking about, like, more Stampede era and early WWF era where these guys, like, were still powerful, but they could also move and they were also great mat wrestlers and they just, like, got in there and systematically destroyed people, especially jobbers whose health they didn't care about.
Oh,
they were,
especially
like, them. They were the proto-Steiner brothers where, like...
Yeah, and that's pretty cool.
You'd get some tubby jobbers in there and they'd just beat the shit out of them and toss them around and really hurt them. And I just loved watching that shit. I still love watching that shit. Like, the dog and the... the Union Jacks everywhere. I don't need that shit. I like their like nice baby blue tights with the simple stripe down the leg and just them beating the shit out of people.
Johnny Ace carrying the flag.
we're getting our worlds are colliding here.
Oh, sorry.
If we did our 1980s amalgam universe, where we mixed up the WCW guys and the WWF guys into new creations, you might have the British Bulldogs in their corner man carrying the flag, Johnny Ace.
What if we get these two British dudes that have a real stranglehold on the Queen's English, and then we fucking give them Johnny Ace holding a Union Jack?
I gotta tell you.
That's fucking a team, pal.
Stranglehold is the word for it.
Hold on, though.
Davey Boy Smith in the English language. This is like Chris Benoit and David Benoit. Just like fucking...
Too soon.
Yeah.
I tell you what.
That's a tight headlock.
I was one funeral away from a Benoit. Had two out of the three.
Oh, wow. Wait, what are we talking about here?
I don't know anymore.
He had three funerals?
Well, he didn't.
Oh, yeah, he didn't attend that.
Yeah.
Chavo did, I guess. Yeah, Chavo sure.
In our future amalgamation world.
I just want to clear up what you're saying here. Where are your dogs right now?
Pool shed.
This doesn't sound great.
Do you need my physical address? I love you.
Let's deal with this after.
If Johnny Ace is...
in a dark place.
If Johnny Ace is with the Bulldogs, is he wearing the Union Jack pants like the Bulldogs do? Or is he just still wearing those... camo.
I think he's probably still wearing some camo.
The camo cargos.
Like, he's got a Union Jack in there somewhere, but
sure,
it's all mixed up. And
Union
it's all
Jack
confused.
Tank top.
And I'm really picturing in this universe, Davey Boy and Dynamite are doing the sheep herders. What's that fucking move where they just bonk the other guy?
Oh, the battering
his head?
Ram.
The battering ram. Yeah, that's their finisher.
Oh, what's that move? I don't know. The greatest tag move of all time.
Do all their fucking mean, just like break your neck shit, and then they end their matches with the big battering, the British battering ram.
We're Davey Rams. Fucking Dynamite Kid's CTE head. Right into another
Malcolm
human
universe.
Being.
This is something that could branch out and change into something. Yeah.
I got a number two.
That's my number three. What's your number two?
Again, I'm just kind of doing your list, but in reverse.
Oh, wow.
You loved them. I was a little too young.
A lot of flip-flopping going around here.
They had a third guy, and I thought it was weird, and I thought everything they did was weird. Mm. But now...
The Freebirds is what you're talking about.
Yeah,
the Jimmy Garvin version,
the
late
Jimmy
era
Garvin.
Freebirds.
It's so good. I got to watch these guys just beat people up. And I'm talking about here come the axe and here come the smash.
Yeah, Demolition.
Yeah, Demolition.
These guys were my number one as a child.
Yeah. And
I loved every weird little thing about them.
A little too young to appreciate it, but here I am now being like, well, these guys just showed up and beat people up.
Ground and
That's
pound.
That's pretty cool.
Ground and pound.
They dress like weird S&M leather daddies.
They make their tongues real red and they stick them out.
Beat people up.
They got
beat them up.
Masks and face paint. Like, that's
fucking
cool as shit.
Yeah, that's a really cool
one. You take off the mask and then you got face paint too.
Like, and if you think about it, like, those masks as a child, those are terrifying masks.
Oh, yeah, sure. You
just
could
terrifying.
Put that in a horror movie right now.
Yeah.
And you'd have like a horror movie villain that people really dug and were like, ooh, that was scary looking.
Yeah, they're straight out of Mad Max.
The fucking Jason mask with leather and studs over the front of it. Like,
it's
great shit. Great shit.
Oh, what am I going to do? Look at this terrible mask. It's terrifying. I'm going to take it off and I'm still painted up. You do not need to know who I am. I'm not the guy that was in that Russian tag team.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Also, not the masked superstar.
No, it was.
We got rid of the Moondog or whatever, who was the original Smash. I forget how that worked out.
It doesn't matter. But either way, Demolition, I give you credit.
Demolition.
Much love.
Very
Much
solid.
Love.
My number two, you know, they're regulars on this podcast. We're watching them all the time. They're a great little package. Looking back, it's all about these bad guys for me, it seems like. And I'm talking about maybe the greatest heels of the 1980s, the Midnight Express.
Ooh.
What a package. Pure heels. Like, you want to talk about, like, the Horsemen ran the 80s as bad guys, but There was a whole contingent out there, even back then, of fans who, like, thought the Horsemen were cool, and they'd show up to the matches in suits, and they liked the Horsemen. Nobody liked the fucking Midnight Express. You got Jim Cornette, nope. Loudmouth, Mama's Boy, obnoxious, never shuts up. You got Stan Lane, just the pretty boy, cocky asshole, doing his Hollywood karate.
Stan Lane's cool AF.
You got Bobby Eaton.
I love Hollywood karate,
looks
by
like
the way.
Fucking mayonnaise slathered Morishima, just a big doughy dumpy idiot who's also just like one of the best pure heel workers of the 1980s, busting his ass out there with not looking good, but then like acting like he looks good. Beautiful Bobby, and the guy's ugly as fuck. That's great shit, man. These guys took huge ass whippings every time.
He looked like a grown-up Cousin Oliver from the Brady Bunch.
Yeah, definitely. He might have been.
Could it could be the same guy.
Anytime these guys are like in charge, it's because they've taken shortcuts and they just get heat by just cheating and cheating.
I love shortcuts.
Anytime the good guys are getting a comeback, they just take serious fucking ass whooping. Serious, that classic Southern style, hitting the mat hard, fucking cutting your head, just begging off and bleeding everywhere and selling the shit out of everything. They did a bunch of cool double team moves like all the time, and like people still didn't even cheer them. Like there was no question. Like, oh, look at that Vegemag. No, nothing. It was just like, we heard it. They got big old F word chants. One of these recent shows we were watching, and the crowds hated them so much. Talking about the fuck word. I'm talking about that real F word. These guys were hated. Cool fucking theme music.
F-A. Get some.
Their dumb tights with rainbows on them. I fucking hated that. Like, ugh. I hated these guys when I was a kid. And I watch back the shit now and I love them.
Hate that shit.
They're so good.
Hate all that shit.
And fucking, you know, Jim Cornette. Goddamn. That guy, his big dumb glasses, his stupid loaded tennis racket, all of his ugly suits. Like, that guy really put together a package that you could boo. There's no reason to like Jim Cornette.
Nope.
That's my
to this
two.
Day. To this day.
Well, I mean, pretty into like cheeseburgers and stuff. I like hearing talk about cheeseburgers.
Yeah, I like burgers. Burgers are good. You put a
crush some Wendy's earlier today.
I'll tell you what, man.
Put down a fucking Wendy's burger and then like fucking, what is it? 10 minutes later, I get done with this shit.
Diarrhea.
Lady of the house gets home from work, comes through the front door. Big bag of Wendy's in her hands.
So you both had diarrhea?
So neither of us had diarrhea. Oh. We're both very, just like, you know, like, we're well-oiled machines at this point. Just like, everyone in this house is Greed feeling good. Got all the nutrients we need. We're ready to go.
You know.
Wendy's, best spicy chicken sandwich on the market.
You know, if you come...
The best.
You come at me and you say... Hey, Big O, you want a cheeseburger? I'm going to be like, maybe not. And then you're like,
hey, your little brother, Davey R. Scheister, I know your older brother, Matt, doesn't want a cheeseburger, but how about you? Do you want a plain hamburger?
Oh, yeah, he's going to
want
that.
No cheese?
He's going to want
and
that.
And he does.
But if you come at me...
he's the blandest man on the planet Earth.
If you... Who is the baddest man on the planet?
That Mike Tyson, I think.
Yeah.
Dave's the blandest man.
Blandest man on the planet. Yeah, we're going to start. Oh, man.
One plain hamburger, please.
Start billing them, man.
Give me a break.
So you come at me with that same cheeseburger, and you're like, oh, P.S., I got a side of bacon I'm going to put
on
there.
P.S. Hayes, I got a baconator.
Doot, doot, doot. I'm eating that all
bacon,
day.
Cheeseburger all together all day. All
right, so anyways.
What?
We're talking tag teams.
Oh, since when?
I don't know.
You're fading fast. We got to get through this.
I've been drinking for days.
What's your number one?
I got a team.
About to have that third funeral.
I got
looking
a team
in your
here.
Eyes. You don't got much time left.
The fire's going out, son. You gotta find a team. And you got your teams, and you got bad teams, and you got good teams.
Sometimes
and you got bad guy teams.
There's a man. I'm not going to say a hero, because what's a hero?
What is a hero? God damn, I love that line. Like, what is a hero? Who knows anymore?
I'm holding out for a hero.
Ooh, it's got to be something. He's got to be short. He's got to be strong from the fight. Sam Rockwell quotes that in The Way, Way Back.
Very
I love
true.
That guy. He finally won an Oscar. Now all
great
of America.
Dancer.
All of America can realize how great of a dude
he is.
He
should win a Tony for his dancing.
So we got a lot of bad guys, and like WCW, NWA, they're full of cool bad guys. You
real
know?
Cool.
You had the Horsemen, and you had the Midnight Express, and all this shit, and it was good stuff.
Mm-hmm.
But you got to have that one team that you can put them up against.
Oh, wow. You got to have a good guy?
And I say this.
I need a hero. I'm holding out for a hero.
Against every part of my moral fiber.
Wow. Where are we going right now?
I'm going to give my number one to the Rock and Roll Express.
I'm losing my mind.
I don't want to, but I got
to. All these weeks, you talking shit about the Rock and Roll Express. You're finally coming around.
I hate their cuts.
Ricky and
They're
Robert.
Stupid losers.
Finally coming around to the
like
Rock and Roll
idiots.
Express.
They look like idiots. They just look like dumb,
man,
dead fish.
You, these guys are
and their faces
sex machines.
Are stupid as hell.
They're teen idols.
They were the first guys to be like, what if we both kick this guy at the same time?
Two kicks at the same time. Yeah,
and like, all this shit's stupid, and it's so stupid, and the stupidest team ever, and their
best team
moves are the dumbest of all the dumb moves.
Rock and roll music.
But all those dumb 80s people just ate it up, and they were like, it's the greatest stuff ever. Like, I knew, like, you know, you hear about it.
Busting some ass out there.
Growing up watching wrestling, like, I knew about the Rock and Roll Express. I was told about the Rock and Roll Express, but, like, they were dead by the time I was watching wrestling. And then,
pretty sure they're still wrestling, friend.
No, they're dead as hell. You gotta be wrong. So, and then, like, I finally go back and watch the shit, and it's like, well, yeah, okay, they're doing
some
things.
Ain't nobody sells like Ricky Morton.
They're doing some things.
Ain't nobody taking an ass whooping like Ricky Morton.
And like, I know they like to do cocaine, and I know they were farting it
allegedly.
Up, like, so,
well, that's been confirmed.
Yeah,
Robert Gibson, the worst farts
cool.
in the wrestling
that's
industry.
Cool.
Also, one of
that.
The biggest hogs.
Ooh,
worst farts Ooh. And one of the biggest hogs. Yeah, this guy's got to be fucking number one. That's all coming out of the same dude. Yeah.
So like,
fuck.
It's a backhanded compliment, but Rock and Roll Express.
It's all compliment. Just your icy veneer is breaking down. You're starting to feel the magic of rock and roll in your heart.
Ding 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 ding.
God gave rock and roll.
Oh,
to
I was thinking
you.
Of a little Dwight Twilley. You.
Looking for the magic. Well, that's good too.
Yeah. Either way, you got a number one?
Yeah, of course I do.
Number one,
and it's the man and the man.
Bob.
And the man and the
you
man.
You are my number one.
Who ruled?
Is it the Masters of the Powerbomb?
The 1980s.
Oh, you said rule. I thought maybe
Masters
it was Masters
of the
Powerbomb.
Power great team. A little short-lived. I just got to give it to the guys who were the guys and nobody else could touch them and they ruled everything. That's, you know, the Four Horsemen. But I'm not giving it to Arn and Ole as the tag team, the Minnesota Wrecking Crew. Great tag team, great tag team. Just grizzled, fucking angry, tough guys who went out there and talked a big game and then backed up that game and broke people down. I'm giving it to the Brain Busters after Ole stepped back and you put Arn and Tully in that role.
Oh, absolutely.
Because they're doing all the same great shit that Arn and Ole did, but you're getting a bigger contrast in personalities. You got one gruff, grizzled guy, and you got one cocky, just like smarmy guy.
Yeah.
Just like that guy who's like the fucking jock quarterback who like picks on people and wears his Letterman's jacket and looks like an idiot. And then like the tough guy who he hides behind after he's run his mouth.
You know I love that dynamic.
Two tough guys aren't as hateable as one guy who runs his mouth and then hides behind the other guy. Like that's
why everybody
sucks.
Loves me.
These guys, they can work, they can talk, they can party. They're just assholes. And just like you put them in there against anybody in any circumstance, they're going to have the best match on the card. They're just perennial fucking top-notch A1 pro wrestlers, Arn Anderson and Tully Blanchard, the Brain Busters, the Horsemen, call them what you will. I'm going to call them the number one tag team of the 1980s.
Adoy, adoy. My number 1A goes to Billy Jack Haynes and anybody ever tagged with.
What about Wahoo. His cousin Brady Boone?
Well, yeah, that's a really good tag team, but his...
They would have got a bigger push.
He had that team with Wahoo. Would have
been legendary.
He had that team with Kenny Patera. He tagged with a lot of...
Some people just like think of him as just like a tag team expert right there.
Tag team specialist.
Tag team specialist, Billy Jerk Haynes.
Kind of like how Animal was after Hawk died.
And Billy Gunn.
Like,
Billy Jack Haynes is the Billy Gunn of the 1980s.
Yeah, but Animal tagged with
Heidenreich.
Draws and Heidenreich.
What? Ooh, that's a missed opportunity there with the whole Draws paralyzed angle. Because what if we could have got like a new LOD that it was just Draws and Heidenreich?
Oh.
Like,
oh,
that could have been something there.
And fresh off like 5 DUI arrests, Tammy Sitch.
Allegedly, as far as she's told me, none of those were legit arrests. Like
this year,
she's been framed every time
for all those ones this year.
These cops have it out for her, man.
Yeah, that's true. That's true.
There's a lot of haters out there, and she's really high profile. She's the most downloaded woman off AOL in 1995, and still a lot of jealousy out there. So it's just people trying to cut her down. She's just trying to live her life, man. She's trying to shine her light like a beautiful star that she is.
I'm gonna go out tonight, and
She got dicks in her ass on film, and she's in the Hall of Fame.
I was just gonna
Why not China?
I'm gonna go download like BearShare or LimeWire or whatever, like
I was gonna say, I don't think these are things anymore.
Streaming thing, and I'm gonna spend all night just working on downloading like Tammy Sitch porn.
That's gonna be just get through all those funerals and then spend a night downloading.
How do you do it?
Tammy Sitch porn on probably like a dial-up modem.
Shit.
That's how you grieve.
What are we going to do next week?
Bunkhouse Stampede. Bunkhouse Stampede.
If I'm here, if I'm alive.
2 weeks Royal Rumble.
Can't even promise.
We got two big bench press competitions coming up.
Gotta lift the weight.
Two big
weight.
Fake battle royal variations. It's going to be hot action.
Maybe you and I can have a bench press competition.
I'm down for it. I'm feeling strong.
What do you bench these days?
I never have a spotter, so I don't ever top out.
Well, what are you throwing up?
I'm throwing up like a 160, three sets of during that workout.
I'll blow out every muscle I have trying to beat you because I just love competition.
I can't wait to watch you shit your pants.
Oh, man. Tune in on Baby Oil.